Very well. Good morning, everyone. So we can continue with the previous lectures, in which we start to get to know about the covariant derivative. And as we have seen, it's a fundamental tool for what we are going to do, because the standard partial derivatives, as we have seen, do not produce a tensor once they are applied to a tensor, a vector, or anything. Okay? So if you have the standard derivative applied to a vector or a tensor, you don't get a tensor. And this is a big issue whenever we want to build up a fully covariant theory. Because you can remind yourself the structure of the Poisson equation, in which we have nabla square to the potential equal to 4 pi g rho. Right? We want to, in the end, arrive at a similar structure in which we have some operator based on derivatives and a tensor on the other side. And since the two are transforming under coordinate transformations, whenever we apply coordinate transformations, we want the two to be coincident. Okay? We want both to transform in a similar way, meaning as tensors. That's why we introduced the covariance derivative, because it's a special derivative that on a manifold fulfills this condition. Okay, whenever we apply the covariant derivative to a tensor or to a vector, we get a tensor or a vector. Sorry, we get a tensor of a higher rank, as we have seen. Okay? So that's the trick that we played. To do that, we constructed this instrument, this covariance derivative, by imposing very basic conditions, if you wish, which are the conditions that we expect for standard partial derivatives. Once we have done that, and we build up, we created our mathematical instruments, then we apply some restriction to our mathematics, to our formalisms. Because the fine connection which is contained within the covariance derivative can have assumed different shapes according to the problem that we have ahead. Okay? So the instrument that we produced was completely general, and it's about manifolds in general. But we don't care about all manifolds. We care only about the manifolds that are associated to a space-time which is curved, in which the curvature is produced by gravity. Is associated to gravity, okay? It's produced by an energy density, as we are going to see. So we are going to have energy density, so matter and energy are going to distort the space-time, introducing the curvature, which then is what we perceive as gravity, okay? Therefore, what we did is start to restrict our formalism, and we introduced a new condition on our properties of the fine connection, which was metric compatibility. Okay? It was like that the covariant derivative applied to the metric equal to zero. Exactly as we would have in flat space-time. When you have the partial derivative of the Minkowski metric is constant and gives you zero. Okay, because it doesn't have any dependency on position. The Minkowski metric here is the Minkowski metric there. In this case, we have differences between the metrics in different locations, okay, because now the metric is dependent on position, but the covariance derivative is built up such that when it is applied to the metric, it gives us zero. Okay, that's metric compatibility. And the idea, if you wish, is that we are kind of creating mathematical instruments that reproduces what you have on a curved manifold. It reproduces what you have on a flat manifold, sort of. Okay? So we are restricting our mathematics, very general, about any possible manifold, and we are starting to restrict it to the case of gravity. Now we are going to impose another condition, which is associated to torsion. torsion free. Because in the covariant derivative, we had this affine connection. It has three indices. I used alpha, beta, gamma. And in general, this is different. Oh, alpha, beta, gamma, I said. Gamma and beta, in general. Nobody tell us that this guy must be symmetric on the lower indices. But we are going to say, yes, it is symmetric on the lower indices. And we call the difference torsion. The difference between the affine connection, tuck and tuck, with the indices like that, and then flipped lower indices, is equal to zero, means torsion free. I already wrote it here, so that means torsion free. You see, if we bring this guy on the other side, we have that the affine connection alpha beta gamma is equal to the affine connection alpha gamma beta. It's symmetric. Okay? So mathematically, again, can be generically. So we can have manifolds in which these two guys are different, in which torsion is non-zero. Here we are imposing, in GR, we are imposing it to be equal to zero. General relativity. You can also have theory of gravity in which torsion is different than zero. You can even have theories of gravity in which you impose the curvature to be equal to zero and you play all the games with torsion. Okay, so you see there are different ways. You have a manifold and you can play with it in different ways and you are going to extract different theories of gravity. In general relativity, that's what we do. We set torsion equal to zero and we work with the curvature because it's the simplest. It's the simplest that can basically predict all the things that we can see. Then theorists also play with different kinds of gravities. They try to make gravity more flexible, if you wish, or they can produce more phenomenologies because, for instance, they want to try to represent the expansion of the universe, which is accelerated, without using the cosmological constant. Trying to avoid the need to introduce dark energy, which is this fluid, so if you remove the cosmological constant, you must introduce a new degrees of freedom to explain this accelerated expansion, which is a kind, sort of a fluid, is a fluid actually, okay, which is called, is treated as a fluid, which is called dark energy, which is this ingredient that produces the expansion of the universe. Okay? Then people say, hey guys, I don't want to introduce such a weird stuff in my equations. Let's try to modify gravity. Let's try to use something which is not GR. Let's play with some other theories. Okay? So it's not that you gain a lot because you are reducing a degree of freedom to put other degrees of freedom in your theory, but it's a valuable way, and people is also trying that, okay? This is just a parenthesis to show you that gravity, if you wish, the gravity business is more complex than GR alone, okay? Maybe we are going to touch some modified gravity theory in the next lectures, in one of the last lectures if we have some time. Okay, anyway, close the parenthesis. Torsion free is one of the basis assumption for general relativity. Okay? Good. So what is the gain now? That we have less degrees of freedom because we have our alpha, beta, gamma, and here we have n possibilities, because and n is equal to 4 in our case. And here we have, if we are assuming symmetry, symmetry for our torsion, we basically have n plus 1 divided 2 possibilities, which give us, if we put this guy together, n squared n plus 1 divided 2, 3 coefficients. And if we have n equal to 2, we are 40 in the dependent coefficients. Against the 64 if we would have not assumed the symmetry on the lower indices of the affine connection. So see, that's quite a gain. 64, because we would have the 68. Because we would have the possibilities would be n to the power of 3. Okay? If we have that, we have further benefits on our equations. In which, for example, if we assume the torsion to be 0, then we have that the covariant derivative is commutative for scalars. Because if we have a scalar function and we compute its covariant derivative, we have seen that this is equal to the alpha, is equal to the standard derivative. And the concept, if you wish, I mean, I added a proof into the script, into, I think, lecture notes 11, in which this is shown clearly. But the idea is that these guys do not depend, scalars do not depend on the basis, because they are not vectors. They are not constructed with as a linear combination of basis. And therefore, they don't care if you move them around. Okay? This is a scalar. And it commutes. What does it mean? That if we apply the covariant derivative twice, so phi alpha beta, which means the covariance derivative applied once along the alpha direction, and the covariance derivative applies once along the beta direction, then this is going to be equal to phi beta gamma. It commutes as for standard derivatives, right? You can always flip the two, you get the same result. For scalars, this is guaranteed. And to prove that, we can just give a look at this object, and you just realize that this is what? This is a one form, right? And we know how to apply covariant derivatives to one form. We have seen that. Therefore, what we do? If we want to apply the covariant derivative twice, meaning I'm doing that, I just apply the construction that we have seen. Therefore, we have phi alpha derivative with respect to beta, minus, because it's a one form, we don't have the plus. Then we have the derivative with respect to beta, first index, alpha, because it's the alpha component of our covariant derivative. But now we need to have a linear combination. Therefore, this is going to be a gamma. Gamma, alpha, that was correct. And then we have phi, alpha. Gamma, God, is the linear combination. Okay? Which is this object? On the other side, we just flipped the lower indices, therefore we get the same, but we flipped indices. Beta alpha minus alpha beta gamma phi comma gamma. And now what? If we are imposing that, we say, let's see what it means if these two guys are equal. What is the condition for which these two guys are equal one to each other? Well, we bring everything on one side. And then what do we have? Phi comma alpha beta minus phi comma beta alpha. So I brought this guy on the other side. Then we have minus the first affine connection. Well, let's bring this guy on the other side. So we have plus beta alpha gamma phi comma gamma minus, plus again, sorry. No, three minus. It's already on the other side. And it's gamma alpha beta phi comma gamma. When these guys are equal to each other in this case? And when is this commuting? When is it commuting? When these two guys, you see, I can put together now gamma, and we have gamma beta alpha phi comma gamma minus the affine connection with the flip indices phi gamma. And they commute whenever this guy is equal to zero. Then we have the commutation. And this guy, you see, is the difference. Oops, he slept in. We have the difference between the two affine connections with the flipped indices. And whenever we are in torsion-free conditions, meaning these guys cancel, are equal one to each other, there is a minus, therefore that's identically equal to zero, then the standard, then the covariance derivative, because we started with that, okay, then they are commuting. Yes?
Maybe, sometimes confused if it's the covariant or the standard derivative with the Jean notation. Could you maybe just show where the whole one?
So, covariant derivative, and you know that within the covariant derivative, which is constructed in this way, we have the standard one.
Okay.
Okay, so is the covariance derivative is the standard one plus a correction term. Therefore, this is the same but with the flipped indices, so this is the normal one. And again, this is the normal one. Okay? If you are not in torsion free, this is not guaranteed. Okay, good. But now, okay, nice. We have our condition, additional condition, torsion free. We know that we have benefits because we have less degrees of freedom. Therefore, our theory is going to simplify because we have less coefficients. But what is the connection to the metric? And the additional benefit is that we have a very precise link with the metric. So given the metric, and given the two assumptions that we constructed, meaning that so we are going to assume that a metric compatibility condition, plus torsion free, it means that the affine connection alpha beta gamma is equal to alpha gamma beta. So given these two assumptions, then we can find the relation with the metric. And the relation is unique. So given these two assumptions and a metric, the affine connection is uniquely defined. Okay, how can we prove that? How can we see, find out what is the relation? Well, we are going to use one of the expressions that we used in the previous lectures. It was deriving from the metric compatibility. So if you go back to the script, you will see that whenever we impose metric compatibility, we have an expression for the standard derivative of the metric and the connection, which reads as follows. Let me copy for sake of speed. Okay, so this was following from the metric compatibility assumption. Okay? Now what we can do? We can cycle the indices. And now we are going to get the derivative A, G, B, C equal to the affine connection gamma A, B, G, gamma C plus the affine connection A, C, gamma, G, gamma, B. And we cycle again. So we cycle three times. Three indices, we cycle it three times. So you see, I'm just flipping the order. I'm just bringing the A here and the C at the back. You see? The A went in front. The B is not, this one is symmetric, so nobody cares. And C is on the other side. Okay? And last cycling, CA equal to BC gamma, G gamma A plus gamma, B, A, G, gamma, C. Now what I can do? I can combine them together by summing and subtracting them opportunely. So I can just do, let's do it here, D, B, G, A, C plus D, C. G, B, A minus D, A, G, C, B, yes. And now I exploit the torsion-free condition. Because look at these two guys, gamma, gamma, B, A is flipped, G, gamma C is the same. The only difference is the fact that I flipped this guy. But I'm subtracting one to each other. Therefore, these two guys cancel. Then, what we have is that, again, look, same business, here and here. AC, CA, these two guys cancel. What we're left are with the two left survivors. And therefore, what we get in the end is that this is equal to 2 affine connection gamma B, C, G, gamma A. Only the metric is left and this affine connection term. So what I'm going to do, I isolate my affine connection term. By doing what? Well, I multiply the two terms, the two sides of the equation, with the inverse of the metric that we know to be G gamma A. Okay? So I'm multiplying G gamma A to this guy and to this guy. And in the end, we have our final expression, that relates the metric to the affine connection. Or if you wish, the way around, we have the affine connection A, B, C equal to 1/2 G, A, gamma, the B, G, gamma, C plus the C, G, B, gamma minus delta gamma G, C, B. These are also called Christoffel symbols. And if we want to be precise, of the second kind. But they are also called Levi-Civita connection. And they're also called Riemannian connection. Okay? So it goes under three names, perhaps there are even many. Okay? So this is a very important piece of information that you need to keep in mind, okay? And again, I repeat it. Where is the stick? Here. What we are doing is to restrict the general approach to manifolds that we are using to the specific case of gravity. And to achieve this point, we assume metric compatibility, which is the condition up there, the covariance derivative of the metric equal to zero, and we are assuming the theory to be torsion-free, meaning that the lower indices of the connection can be flipped, and when we get the same connection. So the connection is symmetric with the lower indices. When we impose this condition, then we can use this expression that was derived thanks to the metric compatibility condition. So metric compatibility, we can write that. Then we just then combine together by summing and subtracting them opportunely, and we get the connection, an explicit expression for the connection with respect to the metric. Okay, these guys are called Christoffel symbols, and they are the guys that once the metric is expressed, gives you the full expression to apply your covariant derivatives. Okay? Last, perhaps useful expressions that you can have. That are a way of re-expressing our Christoffel symbols. Is one with all lower indices, A, B, and C, that is used by using the metric to lower the upper index of the Christoffel symbol. Now I'm telling you why it's not an equal and is a definition, but let me write it first. So gamma B C. You see I'm lowering the top index, which is equal to what? 1/2, because now we have applying this metric to the term up there. And we have G alpha gamma, and there This is GA gamma and GA gamma. Okay? Wait. Gamma. Ah, yes, because I have to relabel. Right, forgot. So, I'm going to apply this guy to this Christoffel symbol up here, but I'm relabeling, otherwise I do confusion, as I did in my head right in this moment, between the indices. So, I'm going to change this A with a sigma. Okay? Because otherwise I get confusion with respect to the indices. Because I'm calling the same index twice into different contexts. When we do that, we get a GA gamma and a GA sigma that give us a delta. Delta A, the sigma, gamma is repeated. So we have a sigma, and then we have okay, of course. Got A and sigma. The repeated index is gamma, and therefore we have the sigma on top and A at the bottom. To all of that, but remember that the A now you have to read it as a sigma. And what we get in the end, we must apply this Kronecker delta to our expression inside, where the A is called 2 sigma, and we get, in the end, 1/2 that we don't touch, the B, G, A, C, plus the C, G, B, A, minus the A, G, C, B. And here, I set it as a definition. I mean, the lowering of the indices kind of work because we are getting this delta and it's lowering all indices. You see, they are all appearing below. There are no indices up there. Therefore, we don't have any more this sort of linear combination where the gamma is repeated. And the reason why I'm calling it as a definition, that's because the Christoffel symbols are not a tensor. Okay, as we have seen, the Christoffel symbol, when we look for the transformation, they don't transform as a tensor. They are not a tensor when we include all three indices. And the lower indices and the lowering of the indices is usually applied to tensors. Okay, so if you wish, this is a sort of definition, and they are called Christoffel symbols. Of the first kind. That's why there is the distinction between first and second kind. Just upper index and lower index. Then something which is useful is a contraction of our Christoffel symbols in which we are going now to the one of the first kind, and we are repeating one index up and one index down twice. You see, now it's A and A. Let's repeat it twice. Therefore, we just get the expression that we have on top here, and we just substitute the index, the B with an A. That's it. So 1/2 G A gamma delta A gamma C, G gamma C plus delta C G A gamma minus delta gamma G C A. You see the B is not there anymore because now B is A is equal to A. Now what we do on the last term, look, because we have a linear combination, therefore you have to think of them as kind of independent terms. We have a summatory, then we have a summatory minus a summatory. Because we have gamma, which is a summatory, gamma, which is a summatory, gamma, which is a summatory. And they are dummy indices, right? Therefore, what we can do is to relabel, we are allowed to relabel gamma, and on the last term, we are basically flipping the indices gamma with alpha. Whenever we are alpha, we call it gamma, and the way around. When we do that, these two guys, even if we don't do that, I mean, one can just see it, but if you flip the indices, this is clear. The labels are, this is clear. And these two guys are going to drop, cancel one each other. Therefore, what we get is 1 half G A gamma delta C G A gamma. But now we can use one of the properties that we've seen for the derivative of the metric, because we can we basically see that this is associated to the determinant and to the minus of the determinant. We have seen that in the previous lecture, so I'm going to use the properties that G now is the determinant. Okay, whenever I talk about the determinant, I'm very clear about it, because you might find like G as the tensor expressing the entire metric. Now I'm clear that this is the determinant of the metric. And we know that it's, when we associate it to its derivative, this can be expressed in terms of the minus GAB, the GAB. Okay? So you see that we have this construction here. So the change in the determinant is related to the minus, which are the first terms here. So it is identical, except that there is a G of too much in front. So what we do? We just divide by G this guy. Let me continue here. And what we get is 1 half over G, and then we have the C of G. That's another convenient expression. Then you can also reshuffle this equation a bit, because you have a derivative of function divided by function. So you know that you can express it as the derivative of the logarithm of the function. And then you have the 1 half, and you can express this as the derivative of the square root of the function, of the logarithm of the function. Sorry, yes. Okay? I wrote them in the notes. I don't repeat them here, because this is not interesting. Then, another expression that is very convenient, well, I do it later, is the divergence, but we will see it later. Okay? Good. So, we can have a little break here. I already did the summary for the upper board, so I'm not going to repeat it. Just two assumptions, and we get the link to the between the affine connection and the metric. And you have it, and it's uniquely defined only because we are assuming metric compatibility and torsion free, which are key assumptions for general relativity. Then I just gave you a few other expressions that are convenient whenever you do mathematics within GR. Okay? So we can have a 10-minute break, so we can meet at 10 past 10.